Busy is an example of the coercive model of behavior that will be essential to our achievement of the UN Sustainable Development Goals. This inclusive, partnership-oriented initiative has helped to clarify the contributions expected of all stakeholders in digital finance, including the contribution expected of ITU.
Digital infrastructure is critical for the functioning of financial infrastructure and the provision of DFS. By design, Fiji was implemented as a partnership between the World Bank, the International Telecommunication Union, and the Committee on Payments and Market Infrastructure, supported by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation.
So to do that transformation from cash to digital requires a bit of hand-holding and training and capacity building. And I could see that perhaps associations and civil society could play a key role hand in hand with government to provide that training locally to men and women who have never used a mobile phone that need to use it for, you know, payments and transaction accounts.
Representation and power matter a lot. And when we look at who's designing and implementing the systems themselves, a lot of times it's also men. And so gender intentionality is challenging if there are no women at the decision-making and policy-making table. So I've been really proud throughout the entire Fiji program, how intentionally the group has really been to ensure that every panel, every working group, every event has female representation.
So since the onset of the pandemic, what we've been doing at the World Bank is stepping up our support to authorities in emerging markets and developing countries. And we have about 170 COVID-related projects spread across 110 countries. And one of the things of particular interest to this audience, I think, is that we've launched and scaled up COVID-19 cash transfer projects in over 55 countries, with about a billion beneficiaries covered in active and new projects. And while digital financial inclusion was a development priority before the COVID-19 pandemic, it's really become indispensable now, both for short-term relief in terms of putting money in the hands of those who need it, but also as a central element of broad-based sustainable recovery efforts.
And central banks specifically, of course, play a key role when it comes to the solid foundations of this Buffy House. As a catalyst, they can facilitate public and private sector commitment to have really a sustained commitment when it comes to financial inclusion across all segments of the population. As an overseer, they can contribute to the conducive framework when it comes to foster innovation and competition in financial services more broadly and payments in specific, and while at the same time obviously addressing the risks.
As governments advance their post-COVID rebuilding efforts, we have the opportunity to leverage digital financial technologies to build back more inclusive, secure, and resilient economies. Fiji offers relevant lessons learned that we can draw on as we build back these infrastructures and policies.
Financial inclusion is not an end in itself. It is a tool to create jobs, improve nutrition, increase access to health and education, and empower especially women. That means much more attention is needed in designing, innovating, and championing services that really help them achieve these goals.
And the pandemic has reinforced this urgent need to transition to digital, but it's also thrown that sharp spotlight on these growing global inequalities, particularly the chronic and sometimes gaping digital divide that separates the digitally rich and the digitally poor, and between men and women. DFS can be a powerful driver of development, but we urgently need to put them within reach of the people who need them. And we need to find ways to empower those people so that they may use these transformational services safely and productively, so that they can improve their own lives and the lives of their families and their communities.